May God bless you with his comforting and empowering presence as we celebrate our Lord's goodness in the life of Peter Peters. You and I, we all live in the season of Advent, but for Peter, Christmas has arrived. He moves from believing to seeing his Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Peter loved the Advent season, and especially the Christmas decorations. If he had been part of the planning of his memorial service, he probably would have voted for Christmas decorations. Yet the decorations you see here today are for you and for me. They are a reminder that we are still pilgrims on this planet. We have not arrived, not yet. Peter has. And so we rejoice with Peter and praise God for his victory in the life of Peter. Today we have come to celebrate and honor a life well lived. At the same time, we recognize separation is painful. And so we allow our souls to feel the pain of separation and loss. And so, friends, thank you that you have come to be with the family of Peter Peters in this special time in their lives. Your presence is important and very much appreciated. I also want to welcome those who cannot be here in person, but are present in spirit and follow us on their screen. Familienangehörige, Verwandte und Freunde von Peter Peters, herzlich willkommen zu dieser Gedenkfeier hier in Eben-Ezer in der Mennonitengemeinde. Als Gemeinde sprechen wir unser herzlichen Beileid aus. Möge der Gott des Trostes dein Begleiter sein, hier in dieser Versammlung oder dort an deinem Schirm. Jetzt wollen wir gemeinsam beten. I invite us all to bow for a prayer. Gracious, loving God, in Jesus' name we come before you. Thank you for your loving kindness and your faithfulness in the life's journey of Peter Peters. We thank you that you called him home at the right time, your time. Your timing is always perfect. We rejoice in the fact that Peter has fought the good fight and has finished the race, and he has kept faith. Now he claims the crown of righteousness, which you have reserved for him. And that is the promise you have given to each one of us who believe in you, our gracious God. Now we pray, give us freedom to remember a life well lived. Give us freedom to express the pain of separation and the joy of resurrection as we worship you, the living God. Gracious God, bless Helen, her children, and their families today, and in the days to come, and the months and years to come, as they learn to live without the physical presence of Peter. You know exactly what they feel and what they will feel and what they will think. And so we ask your blessing and your mercy in their lives. And for this service we pray, may your name be glorified. May it bring comfort to our souls and may it be an instrument to strengthen our faith and our hope in you. In Jesus' name, the anchor of our faith, we pray. Amen. So we want to follow what we have in our program, and we will go step by step as the family has planned this for this service.
Glory. while we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust.
Peters was born to Peter and Tina Peters, Niebergen, on November 26, 1923, in Neuendorf, Ukraine. Peter was their firstborn, with 11 siblings to follow. Four of these siblings died early in their childhood. During the first years of Peter's young life, the family moved a lot. Then in 1934, the family moved to Neuhorst, and Peter went to school here and then also in Neuendorf. In the year 1940, Peter went to trade school in Zaporozhye to learn woodworking. In 1941, Peter was conscripted to use his carpenter skills as a bridge builder in the same area. In 1943, the family fled to Wartegau and were given a place to live in Wadowitz. In 1944, Peter was conscripted into the German army. After the war ended in 1945, and Peter was finished his time in the war prison in Italy, Peter found his parents in Schleswig-Holstein, and here he began to work as a forester.
In 1947, Peter was baptized upon the confession of his faith by Altister Heinrich Winter. In July of 1948, Peter emigrated to Canada, where he had some family. He began working in a sawmill and then later worked for the railroad. In 1949, Peter moved to Vancouver, where he worked in the Georgia Hotel and then later in a furniture factory. During this time, Peter met Lena Helen Claussen. They were married on November 26, 1950, by Prediger Heinz Epp in the West Abbotsford Mennonite congregation. On January 15, 1952, their son Henry was born in Vancouver. And then in March, the little family moved to Bradner Road in Abbotsford. Here they built their first home. At first, the young family went to West Abbotsford Church, and then they moved to the Peardonville Mennonite congregation. At this time, Peter started working for Dairyland in Abbotsford. Here on Bradner Road, three daughters were born to the family, Marilyn, Susan, and Erica. In 1963, the family joined Eben-Ezer Mennonite Church. In this congregation, all four of their children were baptized, and three of the three daughters were married. In 1975, Peter and Helen celebrated their silver wedding at Eben-Ezer Church.
In 1978, Peter and Helen moved to Clearbrook, and the same year, Peter needed to have a heart operation. After his heart operation, Peter worked for six more years. In 1985, Peter retired from his job at the milk plant. After Peter's retirement, Peter and Helen enjoyed many blessed years with their family, friends, relatives, and their church family. Predeceased are Peter's parents, Peter and Tina Peters, sisters Tina, missing since the war, and Erna, brothers Jake, John, and Henry, as well as four siblings who died in infancy, and his son-in-law, Dave Gauci. Peter is survived by his loving wife, Helen, as well as a brother, Ernie, and his wife, Betty Peters, sister Marge, and her husband, George Schellenberg, brother-in-law, Bill, and his wife, Ruth, and sister-in-law, Phyllis Peters. He is also survived by his son, Henry, and his wife, Linda Peters, and their and three daughters, Marilyn and her husband, Eugene Clausen, Susan and her husband, Gordon Peterson, and Erica Gauci, 14 grandchildren and many great-grandchildren and two great-great-grandchildren.
My name's Henry. Just a few words about my dad. As most everyone would agree, Dad was a pretty remarkable man. He was a He was strong in his convictions and beliefs, but also in his love for family and friends. Dad and mom too, of course, always had a close relationship with their children, their grandchildren, and even their great-grandchildren. In regard to grandchildren, it's quite amazing to hear and see the comments and now tributes about how much their opa has meant to them. It almost seems as though they all feel that they have that very special relationship with their opa. But somehow my dad has managed to make even each grandchild feel special and is able to relate to everyone in a unique and special way. Dad and mom both have always been incredibly generous people, both with money, gifts, and by helping others whenever they felt necessary. Of course, most of all, they were always generous with their love. That was shown in many ways, especially their hospitality. I don't think my dad grew up being a hugger, but somehow along the line, this changed. Pretty hard not to when you're married to my mom. Anyway, for many years now, decades actually, it has been virtually impossible to enter or leave my parents' home without getting a big embrace. My mom and dad have always been a very close couple, and their love and support for each other has always been a great example for myself and Linda. Dad has always been a hard worker, both on the job and at home, and he took pride in being a good provider for his family. Dad was also a jack of all trades, and there was very few things he wouldn't tackle in the way of projects and repairs at home. And Dad didn't just jump into the car and head off to the hardware store. He'd make a list of materials and wander through the workshop and behind the barn and any place else he could think of and take a thorough search of what he could find to make it happen. I imagine we were one of the last little hobby farms that actually used homemade hay rakes that Dad made from scratch from young alder trees he found on the property. And I can still remember Dad and I working on a Mother's Day gift made from a piece of scrap sheet metal that we cut in the shape of a heart with empty 22 shells soldered on for legs and a candle holder soldered on top. But at least that's the way I remember it. And then more recently, Dad gave me a box full of fishing tackle that he didn't expect to use anymore. Later, when I went through this box of goodies, I found an old reel on which Dad had replaced a broken handle with the crank handle from a car window. No automatic openers in those days. And needless to say, a little strange looking, but it works good. For many years, Dad also loved to get out on his fishing trips to Dutch Lake once or twice a year. These are mostly with his brothers to start with, and there are lots of entertaining stories to go along with these. You'll just have to talk to Ernie or somebody else. But after a time, wives were also sometimes included. In later years, Mom and Dad made quite a few of these trips on their own or with another couple, and I think just maybe Mom became Dad's favorite fishing buddy. I think there were even a few times when Mom outfished Dad. But I think since all the fish wound up in the same frying pan, it didn't really matter to Dad, even after a little teasing. Anyways, I could say much more about my dad, but I'd better bring this to a close. I will just say that Dad truly enjoyed life and that joy was felt by all around him. Dad never feared death, and even when he shared some pretty frightening experience that he lived through, and someone would say, "You must have been scared," Dad would look you straight in the eye and say, with a very serious but slightly puzzled look, "Well, why would you be scared?" And Dad had many wonderful conversations with myself about prophecy, end times, and eternal life. And I knew and understood that a part of him was looking forward to this. And maybe if he hadn't felt so much love around him, he wouldn't have stayed here quite so long. But everyone knew my dad loved to get together, and we just know that he's looking forward to the greatest party of all. I think I'll conclude with that. Thanks.
Our dad loved to be with people, his church family, his coffee buddies, and his whole family. Even in the last year of his life, Dad wanted to get together with a whole family. Mom thought one family at a time would be just fine, but Dad wanted everyone to be together. At church, too, Dad missed the coffee times and the meals with the church family. COVID and aging seriously disrupted, but did not stop Dad's interactions with people. Dad was interested in our lives. He was proud of our accomplishments, but I think he was even more proud of the way we care for our families and support each other. Dad, Opa, was aware of some of the challenges that we each face. He was concerned and tried to steer us toward what would be life-giving for us. We didn't always agree with his views, but we knew his heart was for us. When I was growing up, Dad and Mom were always working. They were new immigrants making a new life in a new country. The way we spent time together as a family was by working together. Plucking chickens, haying, hoeing, digging potatoes, cleaning fish, making sausage, stirring cracklings in the cauldron, etc., etc. These were good family times, but I missed more relaxed times with Dad and Mom. Happily, I did get many, many good conversations with Dad during my adult years, and I still love working together as a family. Dad always said, everyone is different, and that's a good thing. Life would be too boring if we were all the same. I'm glad Dad lived until he was 98, because it was only in this last year that I realized that Dad loved different things about each one in his family. He loved us all as unique individuals. By doing this, he made each of us feel like we had a special place in his heart. Just think of it, you all do. Lastly, I just have to say that Dad was endlessly thankful to God for all the good things in his life. Canada, food, warm home, warm bed, friends, church home, his cherished wife, Helen, and the whole gang that is his family. Thanks, Andrea.
I was doing so good till Uncle Henry spoke. So I'll try. I always cry. The day I heard Opa passed away, about a half an hour later, I just went and typed my thoughts down, and this is just what it is. So, a man of stories, a man of full of life with family and friends to share with it with. I will miss my Opa, my mom's dad. A man that cared for his family. He always had an open door for everyone that came by. The life my Opa lived for just over 98 years had trials. Trials that we will never be able to fully comprehend. Being a young soldier in war many years ago and eventually living out all of his fellow comrades, his friends, to keep living and to say goodbye to so many others over the years. Only someone that has lived so many decades and decades knows what that would be like. A man that moved from another country not because of an idea about an opportunity that we hear so much about in this day and age, but because staying where he was simply meant not actually living very well. But for my Opa, moving meant He had no job. It meant a different language. It meant fleeing. We do not know what that looks like. We do not know fear from staying somewhere. My opa married a wonderful lady, Helen, my oma. It's hard to even describe how much of a caring person my oma is. And my opa. They had four children together. All those four children got married and had a combined 14 children, and so many of those children have gone on to be married and have their own children. These people exist today because of my opa and oma. Family, simply put, family was the most important thing in life to opa. He had a career. He put in many years working mostly at the milk plant in Abbotsford, but it was family that kept him going, I believe. That was what was important to him. He believed that working hard was important, being honest, caring for others, friendship, and love. He loved to celebrate life. I think birthdays was his favorite. I think to celebrate his birthday, in fact, was not celebrating a day, but for weeks at a time every November. And why not? I believe he lived more than 30 years longer than he expected, what he told me. Christmas, Thanksgiving, Easter, all those times, celebrate his family. I have so many good memories in their old house. When someone leaves this earth, I think we ask ourselves how we will remember them. How I will remember my opa. Mostly his stories. He often started with, "When I did come to Canada," and he would go on about a story from his first experiences in the country. Something back in Germany, something he and his friends did, or a story of the milk plant. I always listened with fascination. And now I wish I had more stories. I felt close to my opa, I always have. He spoke about years ago herding cows and goats and sheep back in his homeland. He worked in the milk plant for most of his working life. And it's because of these things, I think that I felt a connection with our work, our appreciation for just land and animals. And my last two visits with him, I spoke to him about my farm and where I milk goats, and I showed him pictures of my goats out grazing our fields, and I spoke to him about regenerative farming, something that I've become passionate about, and he had not heard the term. However, I spoke to him about it, and he said, "That makes sense," with a smile on his face. He was engaging, he asked questions and gave input. I believe it is people of my opa's era that we should look to for advice and to learn from. To live a more simplistic lifestyle does not mean you miss out. It means connection. He was a giver, not a taker. He lived simply, not luxuriously. He was a fixer, not a consumer. He showed us ways to live. It's up to us how we want to choose to live. Peter, Pete, Peters, what a name. My opa, whom I'm so blessed to have known for my entire life. I love you, Opa. I will miss you so much.
My name is Matt, Barry's brother. Don't have too much to say. I can't, how am I going to follow up on that? I think a lot of people say, you know, 98 years is a long life, and it was, so we can appreciate that, but I think my mom said it best when she said, when somebody is around that long, you expect them to live forever, you know, to be here forever. And I think we all kind of fell into that and believe that. Yeah, as my Uncle Henry said, Opa was a hugger. I'm a hugger. Opa and Oma give the best hugs. I think just close your eyes for a moment. If you know my Opa, you've probably hugged him. Just think about what it feels like to be held by Opa. He had a special hug. I think we all would like to give Opa one more hug. So yeah, let's not forget that feeling of an Opa hug. And if we need another hug, I'm sure Oma has it for us. Oma, we love you.
I just want to read a little something from my daughter, Sherry. She wasn't able to come. I don't know if I can do this after hearing my voice, though. So, okay. This is what Sherry wrote to Opa. As a child, your lap was always available for a cuddle and your listening ear welcome to chat. Outdoors, I remember looking for the perfect branch at Mill Lake for you to carve a whistle for me. That little knife would also make an appearance when you cut my Big Mac styrofoam container in half. What a delightful day that was when you thought I was big enough to be able to eat a burger all by myself. You seemed larger than life, always willing to help and be present. Even as a child, I knew that us kids often drove you crazy with our rambunctious laughter and noise. However, you always welcomed us and reminded us that you loved us. As I grew older and outgrew your lap and the green chair, it was always made clear to me that I was still welcome. I've always appreciated the way you would call me into the living room to sit down and to tell him what was happening in my life. You did this because you genuinely cared. When I was in university, you asked me about my classes and what I was learning. I always thought it was so funny how you called me the little teacher. Your life and the history of my family inspired me to major in history while in university. I have loved all of our chats about your growing up years and your life before coming to Canada. While I know that it holds many painful memories, it has helped me to understand you and Oma better and your beautiful perspective on life. This appreciation and desire to not take anything for granted has had a tremendous impact on me. I'm so grateful for this. Thank you for always taking time for me and making sure that I knew without a doubt how much you believed in me.
Thank you. I have five daughters. I drown in the sea of estrogen every single day. And my girls, my oldest is 18, my youngest is 5, they love the Where's Waldo books. You know, the ones where the guy's wearing a red and white striped shirt? You're supposed to find him in a big crowd. So I like playing Where's Waldo. So let me just ask you a question. Where is Peter Peters? I know where Peter Peters is. Do you know where Peter Peters is? We have the promises of God's word, which we're going to look at this morning. But as we're doing this, I just want you to really apply what we're reading and think about, does that really apply to Peter Peters? We ended with a verse. I'm going to read it again in a moment. But if this is true, what God has said, and we remember and think about Peter Peters' life, then we know exactly where he is. And if I was going to offer you any comfort today at all, wouldn't that be the best comfort? That we know exactly where he is right now. So I want to start with something that we all know. We all move one way through life. We are born, we grow, we go through the phases of life, and one day we pass on from this life. And along the way, we look back, we reflect. And we reflect because you and I know that we cannot change what has already happened to us. We can think about it. We can think about the decisions we made and the decisions of others and the circumstances around us. But they've already passed us by. We experience the consequences and the echoes of what has happened, but the past itself, it cannot be changed. But what you and I can change is how we're going to remember the past. The man or woman who knows God has an opportunity to remember all things, even the most painful of memories, and feel thankful. Grateful to a God who is always loving, always safe, and always there. To a God who brings us through everything. And Peter P. Peters was a thankful person because of his connection to a holy God who works in all things for the good of those who love him. This is evidence of where he is right now because we saw it in his life. He was connected to God. We have this thing we do with our kids in Sunday school. It goes like this. It's really simple. With God in life, with him in death, with him in life after death. With him in life, with him in death, with him in life after death. And we see this, that Peter was truly with God because he was thankful. Think of the things he went through. We reminisced about some of them. Some of you know more. Those of you who have been around longer probably know more about the sad details and how difficult things were. And yet, thankfulness, we hear that again and again when we think about Peter, how thankful he was. Because he experienced the presence of God, and that transformed what he went through and how he remembered what he had already gone through. His past and his present and his hope for the future, this beautiful hope, was all framed because he dwelt with God. So let's think about that as we read Psalm 91, 1 and 2. It says this, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." And then it shifts to first person, to testimony. "I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust." The first thing is the statement of truth. He who dwells with God is with God and experiences all the beauty of being with God. And then the second part is this beautiful testimony. "I have experienced God. He is my refuge and my strength." See, the Bible tells us that God has a secret place, a safe place, like a cabin hidden away in Central Park in the middle of bustling New York City. There's a place in the middle of all that craziness where you can go, and it's quiet and it's peaceful, and that is the presence of God, and we can be there. The Bible uses the word abide, and Peter abided with God. We can truthfully personalize the verse that we just read by saying, Peter dwelt in the secret place of the Most High. So he abides under the shadow of the Almighty. Past tense, present tense, right? He dwelt in the secret place of the Most High. He abides under the shadow of the Almighty. With him in life, with him in death, with him in life after death. We could go on. Peter says of the Lord, "He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him I will trust." Now, I know it sometimes feels a little bold to put our own names into a Bible verse, But we're not changing or rewriting the Bible, of course. That would be wrong. Instead, we are remembering that the Bible is the living word of God to us and is absolutely intended for us to be impacted personally by it. So the problem is sometimes when we put our names into a verse that we wonder if our name really belongs there. Am I good enough to really hold on to this promise given to the righteous? Am I just fooling myself? Do I wish that this verse applied to me? But I would remind you that the Bible is written to sinners like you and I, imperfect people that are dearly loved by God. So loved by God that he made a way through the sacrifice of his son for us to be made right with him and to be transformed by him over time. So when God makes a promise or even just states a fact, then those who have put their trust in Jesus can feel confident that the promise or statement applies to them. So no guilt at all in talking about how Peter dwelt with God. Now he abides with God. This is true. Amen? We read it and it's so easy to say, oh, that's sacred and it's important, but is it personal? Does it apply to us? And let me just suggest to you, if it so obviously applies to Peter, could it not obviously also apply to you and I? Can we not also dwell with God and therefore know we will abide with him now and in the future, with him in life, with him in death, with him in life after death? And that's hope. If I was going to offer you any hope or comfort, it wouldn't just be where Peter is now. It'd be that you will see him again. Amen? If I want to offer you any comfort, I want it to be real comfort, rather than a phrase like it's going to be okay or after a while the pain will dull. Sure, that's a type of comfort. But the Bible has something so much better for us to hold on to. So I want to present four pieces of evidence to you so that you will not think I'm just making this up, that Peter dwelt with God, therefore abides with God. So the first thing is Peter's own testimony. As we have heard, Peter declared his love for God, made a decision to trust in Jesus, and surrendered his life to God in baptism. These are facts. There are many witnesses to the fact that Peter did this. These are very personal decisions that can only be made by someone for themselves. Nobody else made this for Peter. This is Peter's decision he made for himself. A person's testimony about themselves in this matter absolutely stands as a fact. If someone says, I am a follower, they are a follower because it is their declaration to make, and he made that. Piece of evidence one. Piece of evidence two, God's testimony about Peter's testimony. Romans 10, 9 to 11 says, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, Peter did that, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, Peter did that, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. And it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. So since God himself has said Peter's testimony is true, since it is so clear that that is the way things are now, this reality, we can hold on to it and accept it, the declaration of Peter's heart, what he said. And the same is for you and I. Not about getting good enough so that then we can ask Jesus to forgive us, you know, because surely I as a sinner could never come to him and say, please forgive me, please love me. No, that's not true. He already loves us. He's already offered us forgiveness. And if I was going to offer you any comfort, it would be that what we're talking about is not just for this next life that you could see Peter again and be with him, but in this life you could experience what he experienced and then have a thankful life that he did. If you were going to live your life, should it be filled with bitterness or thankfulness? Again, if I was going to offer you any comfort, it's that this life right now can be better. If you think about the testimony and the example of Peter. So there's his testimony, there's God's testimony about it, and I've already mentioned this thing, this is the third thing. Look at his life, look at Peter's attitude of thankfulness. Peter chose to experience his past and his present and his future life mindful of God's presence with him. He dwelt in the tent of God, he abided with him. And you know what that made him? That made him untouchable. Untouchable to bitterness. Unswervingly, unstoppably thankful. Some people go through things, and it's very easy to choose bitterness or resentment or anger or even just indifference. Hey, I'm going to be dull to life. Whatever happens, happens. I don't want to engage in what's happening around me. It hurts too much. The potential to be hurt hurts too much. But not Peter. He was grateful. He lived out, his life was proof of God's presence in his life. So yes, Peter is indeed resting in the secret place of God, with him in life, with him in death, with him in life after death. And not just around him in the general vicinity of God, he is close to him. Think of how close you have to be to someone for their shadow to fall on you. Remember, he now abides in the shadow of God. You have to get really close to be in someone's shadow. Peter was in the shadow of the Almighty God. Not like in darkness in the shadow, but in closeness in the shadow. Cause and effect. Peter was close to God, and it made him thankful. Piece of evidence three. Here's the fourth thing, and this was also mentioned. How Peter celebrated with his family, because he loved a good party, right? Peter loved times of celebration, birthdays, anniversaries, holidays, retreats, getaways. He did not content himself with thankful memories of the past. He resolved to celebrate God's goodness now, and also to anticipate the next time we were going to come together to celebrate God's favor in the future. What a wonderful way to live life. What an amazing way to live life. Finding something to celebrate now, looking forward to the next celebration, grateful for what had happened in the past. That's why he was bulletproof. That's important. This speaks to someone who has experienced the secret place of God and knows that nothing can separate him from it in the past, present, or future. Why not celebrate? Why not enjoy life? Why not laugh and enjoy one another? Romans 8, 38, 39 says, I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That is cause for celebration. And why not? With him in life, with him in death, with him in life after death. So look at the evidence. What an amazing way to live life. And again, if I was going to offer you any comfort, it's that today and tomorrow and the day after can actually be better for you as you reflect on Peter's life. You can still learn from him. He's not gone. And if you listen to what we're saying here today, you will see him again. Consider your past with your husband, your dad, your uncle, right? Consider him as you contemplate the present, your present, the next season, the future, your future, without his physical presence and reminder in your life. Because that's part of mourning, is to realize it will be different. We live in anxious times. And so now as you are mourning, do you have a connection with God that will generate thankfulness even in this? I don't just mean gratitude for pain we've been spared. I mean, hey, I'm not flooded. Hey, I'm not sick. Hey, I'm not in the hospital. Hey, I'm doing okay. But I'm talking about the deep spiritual awareness that God is with you in the worst of it all, even in the deepest pain, and that you can have a reason to celebrate and rejoice like our dear brother Peter. And if you do, you will shine in a dark season, even as you are in the shadow of God. Charles Spurgeon, the great preacher, wrote, "Men are apt enough to proclaim their doubts and even to boast of them. Indeed, there are people nowadays who glory in casting suspicion upon everything. Hence, it becomes the duty of all true believers to speak out and testify with calm courage to their own well-grounded reliance upon their God." Amen. May you and I find and dwell in the secret place of God, just like Peter did. May we find rest in the shadow of the Almighty like Peter did. That is the comfort we have this morning. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask for nothing more than what you have ready for us. Your comfort, your presence, connection to you. And we pray, Father, that you would make our memories come alive of our dear brother. And that would change us today. Please help us to mourn well. Please help us to live well and to remember well and to be thankful. And we thank you again, Father, for our brother Peter. We have been blessed because of him. We bless you because of him. And we look forward to seeing him again. We have that hope because of you. Thank you, Father. I pray this in your beautiful name. Amen.
want to conclude this service with the closing prayer and benediction. And after that, I invite you all to sing along the song, Take Down My Hand. If you would like to connect with the family, then please stay seated. And then when all those that want to leave have gone, then come and connect with the family and share what you had in mind to share. I invite us now to bow for the prayer and benediction. Gracious God, you are the strength of all those who trust you. Wherever you lead, we want to follow you because your ways are perfectly wise and loving. Even when we walk through dark valleys, your light can shine into our hearts and guide us safely through the night of confusion and sorrow. O Lord Jesus, we want to be yours. Let us never fall away from you. Bring us close to you. Teach us to accept the joys and sorrows of life without complaining, for you can transform every situation for our good and for your glory. Blend our wills with yours, and then we need not fear anything. Lord, keep us in your love. Comfort us with your light and guide us with your Holy Spirit. And now, family, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to each one of you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you comfort and joy and peace for the rest of your life. In Jesus' name, amen.